I'm going to talk about a project with the Space Center. So this is a joint work with Stepan and Anton. So they should be both in the room somewhere.
You have to get
the audio. Oh, sorry. Hi. So this is a joint work with Stepan and do you something? Stepan and Anton. And as is what it was said, I'm François Fleury. So this project takes place in the context of the ExoMars orbiter mission, and we want to process the data provided by the CASIS imagers, which was built in Bern. So the CASIS imaging system is a very sophisticated camera, which basically is going to take pictures of the Mars surface. And the overall objective of the project is to reconstruct the surface, the terrain of the planet. And so, so right now I don't have feedback of my, it's pretty, sorry for that. Because I don't have feedback of the image on my screen. And that's kind of very difficult. Okay, that's far better. Sorry for that. Okay, so the problem we want to solve is to reconstruct the surface of the planet, and for this stereo reconstruction system, the state-of-the-art systems are using now heavily machine learning. So usually what you do is that you get a training set for which you have the ground truth, you train a heavy machine learning system, and from this you can build, so you can rebuild the 3D, the depths, on new images. In our case, due to the mission, we do not have training data. So we could train on other data sources, but we know by experience that being able to train on the same data you have to process improves the performance. So we are in this situation when, on the one hand, we would like to train on the data we are going to have to deal with, but on the other hand, we don't have ground truth data to train. So what I'm going to show here is a technique we developed to try to manage to train in an unsupervised manner without training data. So disclaimer, because everything I'm going to show is stereo vision, but we do not have processed the CASIS data yet, which just arrived after we finished this part of the work. So in the usual machine learning paradigm, what you have is a bunch of pairs of, so in the supervised framework, you have a bunch of pairs of examples for which you have the available signal X on the thing you want to predict Y. And from this, you usually minimize the loss. You will try to optimize the parameter W, so which for deep networks are the weights of the network, to minimize the loss, which is usually the loss summed over the samples. And the question is, can we do without having access to the labels? So for instance, for image classification, you do not have access to the actual object on the image. In our case, you don't have access to the actual distance to the sensor of the scene. In practice, we can, and so it's what I'm going to show. If you use a strong prior you have over the joint structure of the Ys, so even if you do not know individual Ys, you can still exploit the fact that they are highly constrained. So for instance, if you look at clouds and you hallucinate some faces, you know they can't be a face in the clouds, and it helps you, the context helps you fix, even if you don't have access to the label, nobody told you there was no face in the sky, you can still use your knowledge about the constraint over the ground truth without having access to it to fix your model and say, okay, this should not be seen as a face. So it's something I've been working on for several years now, this idea of using specifically sequence structure over labels to solve problems. So for instance, here what I'm going to show for this work and for the two examples that follow is that we make the assumption the Ys are actually coming, actually have a sequential structure. So for the two examples coming right now, it's a temporal structure. And for the CASIS image reconstruction, terrain reconstruction, it's actually a spatial linear structure. So for instance, you could have a constraint such as you know that over your training examples, you do not have more than a certain number of changes of labels. Or you could know in a more geometrical manner that if the y's are not discrete labels but metric data, you could know, for instance, that the jump from one sample to another is upper bounded by a certain margin. In which case, if you know that such a constraint is true, you can now, instead of just minimizing your loss over your data, so just aggressively optimizing W to minimize your loss, you can go back and forth between optimizing the predictor you are actually interested in and optimizing the labels that you don't have access to under the constraint that you know is verified. So instead of simply, I give you the labels and you optimize your model, what I'm going to give you is a constraint that I know the labels verify, and then you are going to go back and forth, you optimize a little bit your predictor, you optimize your labels, optimize your predictor, optimize your labels. So the two examples I did in the past, so this is an object detection problem where, so as you know, getting labels is often expensive, and if you want to train from videos because you have a high frame rate, it can be super expensive. So if I give you 4 hours of video and say, okay, I want to label every single frame, you have 3,000 frames per hour, 3,000 seconds per hour, 25 frames per second. So it's very, very demanding. So what we did here was that we have only access to the actual location of people 1 frame per second, so those are the green boxes. On the rest, so the blue boxes are obtained by precisely alternating the optimization of a detector, so which is a Petrosian detector, and optimizing the trajectories which we know are continuous. So we go back and forth, and at the end, so we also apply this to tracking neurons in time-lapse videos. And what is very interesting in this is that the error rate you get eventually for the detection is better having a sparse labeling of that sort plus this alternating learning scheme than if you had access to full labels. So the reason is that you let the system in some way fix the ground truth in a maybe a slightly different way compared to a human, an expert which would have labeled the data, but which is more adequate to its own representation of the data. Another example, which is more recent, was to do action selection from a teacher. So here we have a bunch of tasks in a video game, in a 3D environment. And here, for instance, we make a demonstration where first we go to the blue flag, we touch it, and then we go to the red flag. And what we want to do is a predictor end-to-end that gets the raw image as input, so the raw pixels, and that the output tell us the action to do. And what is kind of difficult here with this task is that because you first have to go to the blue flag and then to the red flag, it's kind of inconsistent for the, it's not a Markovian problem, because when you look at the image, sometimes you will see the red flag on your right and you go on the left, sometimes you see the red flag on your right and you go on the right, so it's kind of inconsistent. And again, we use the temporal structure by telling the system, okay, there are macro actions actually, you do something for a while and then you change and then you go you do something else for a while. And what we did was to jointly train those image-based action prediction, so a few of them, plus segment every single exemplar sequence into those macro actions. And here what you see is actually what the system does in inference. And you can see that in the upper left corner, we put a color code for the macro actions he picked. And it had naturally, automatically segmented all the sequences into those two macro actions. And we apply this to several tasks. And each time it helps that the system can discover by itself that there are actually different subtasks in the problem. Okay. So before talking about what we did for CASIS, maybe a crash course in stereo imaging. So stereo construction consists of estimating the depth from two views taken from different angles. And it's basically why we have two eyes. It's because when you have two slightly shifted images, shifted sensors, you can reconstruct, estimate the Z. And in the case of the Mars Explorer, so the CASIS camera has a mechanical structure which allows it to actually move the sensor physically in the probe during the orbiting. So what it does is that it shoots a bunch of images and then moves the camera and shoots a bunch of other images. So in the end, you have for every point on the ground, you get a bunch of images of the point seen from two different angles. And due to the magic of optical systems, when you take two images with the same camera from two different poses, you know that a point taken in one of the image, so you take two images with the same camera, now you take one pixel in one of the image, you know for some optical reason that the corresponding point in the other image, so if you go to the physical point in the scene and look where it is, which pixel corresponds to it in the other image, you know that this point has to be on a line. You don't know where on the line, but you know that it has to be on a line. And this goes both ways. So at the end of the day, and you can also, again, simply with optical formulas, you can rectify your images such that at the end, given any horizontal line in an image and a point on it, you know that any point from this first horizontal line has to be correspond to a point on another horizontal line. You don't know which one, but you know that this line, every point of this line are associated to points on this line. And now the actual matching will be related to the depth. So we can make this more precise with this figure. So here what you see are the two locations of the two possible locations of a camera. So imagine the probe have moved a little bit in the atmosphere of Mars. And then you take a point, so you have those two blue lines correspond to the images taken by the camera, camera one, camera two. If you take a point on the first image, it corresponds to a physical point, which corresponds to a point in the other image seen by the second camera. And if you move in the first image, and it will move on the physical plan, and if you look at the correspondence, so the x of the point in the image and the x of the point in the other image, you see that at first, because the ground is flat, this goes along a line. But when you start to have elevation, then you get away from the diagonal and you come back there later on, okay? So bottom line, you can forget everything I've said. The only stuff you have to understand for the rest of the talk is, if we have, our goal in life now is, you give me two images of Mars that correspond roughly to the same part of the planet, and given any point in the first image, I want to find its matching in the second image, and I know before doing anything, before even looking at the image, that this point has to be on a certain line. So finally, what we truly want to do is to find what we call the matching score or matching cost, which is if you give me a little patch in the first image, I am going to visit the corresponding horizontal line in the second image, compare all the patches, and look at the one which matches the point in the first image. If I'm able to do this, I'm in good shape because I have x1 and x2, and I can compute the z on the planet. Okay? So now, for what follows, all the knowledge in optic and the epipolar geometry and everything we can forget, what we need to be able to build is a patch comparing function. You give me two patches, two little images of typically resolution 9.9 or 11.11, and they have to tell you, yes, high score, they are probably the same location on the ground, or low score, those are definitely not the same location on the ground. So a very naive way of doing this is simply to take the L1 norm. So you give me the two patches, I just go through all the pixels, sum the L1 norm, the absolute value of the difference. If it's low, I'm happy. If it's high, I'm not. But as you can see, and actually Stepan sent me this image, which are actually from Mars and actually from the Cassis mission, you can see that it cannot be as simple. Let's just look at the shadows. The illumination changed quite drastically between the two images. So it's not difficult to understand that we can gain something by letting the system build a smarter metric, able to understand that, okay, I have a cliff. If I have a cliff, then this shadowing is different, and I should compare differently. So there is a whole industry of designing cost functions to compare patches, but as in all the other topics, with the winner are deep convolutional networks. So this is a Siamese network from a paper by Le Koun and a student, quite recent, actually, 2016. So for people not familiar with deep learning, so this is each branch, each vertical branch here. Is a fully convolutional network. So you have the patch as input, then you do convolution, relu, convolution, relu, convolution, relu a bunch of times. Then they do a normalization of the patch. What is a bit specific here is that you put the two patches as input and you do the exact same processing on both. So it's why it's called a Siamese network. And then at the end, because you have done so many convolution, you have reduced, you went from 11.11 to something far smaller with more channels, and you just apply inner product to get the similarity measure. So in the end, we have a deep network with two ways and shared. And when you do the back prop on the learning, you just force the weights to evolve, to change consistently in both branches. So the two networks remain identical during the training. Total is 150,000 parameters, which is not so huge, but the image we are processing are small. So this thing, trained in a supervised manner, does marvel. So it works very well. It beats everybody. So now, in the fully supervised case, in this paper, for instance, what you do is that you get the ground truth with the stereo imaging using a laser scanner, for instance. So you have your two cameras taking pictures, and plus a laser scanner that gives you an accurate measurement of the distance of the sensor. And then you train your deep network with this, because now for every patch using the laser scanner information, you're able to find the corresponding one, and you can tell the network, okay, those two goes together, matching cost should be low. And then you can take a patch, another one which is far away from the corresponding one, and say, okay, and those two patches are not should not have a high score. What they did use was a margin-like loss, which basically what it does is that you want to push away. If you give me a pair of patches which correspond and a pair of patches which do not, I want the gap of the score between those two to be higher than the margin, let's say higher than one, which is I want the bad matching to be worse than one, to have a score worse than one than the good matching. And if it's worse than one, then I give up. I don't push the network anymore. OK, so what we propose to do is to train without ground truth at all. The only thing we are going to use is a bunch of constraint that we know are verified. So the first one is an upper bound on the disparity. So as soon as we know the minimum distance of the sensor, we know that when you take the patch and the corresponding one, the gap between the x's so cannot be greater than an upper bound. So this is a physical constraint that is absolutely sure. Then you have continuity. You know that on ordering, you know that if you go along the line, the corresponding cannot jump around from one side of the to the other of the image. You can have pathological case if true. You had, for instance, you know, a moon passing between you and the planet, but this is very unusual. And so, in practice, what we can do is you give me two epipolar lines that we know correspond from two images. What I can do is to compute for every pair of patch the matching score. And now my goal in life is to find a correspondence, to find a continuous path that for every point, every x in the first epipolar line match an x in the second epipolar line. And it's a continuous path like this. And because I have an upper bound on the disparity, so the gap between the x's, I know that my path is constrained in the blue area, and my other constraint forces it to be continuous and stuff. And as for the two examples I showed of both the pedestrian tracking and the macro action learning, we can use the dynamic programming to find this path efficiently. So there would be other ways far more computationally intensive, but here's the problem is that we have basically to optimize this path for every epipolar line we are going to put in the learning. And as you know, this is usually large-scale learning where we are going to use hundreds of thousands of epipolar lines and weeks of training. So we cannot pay the price of having heavy optimization for every epipolar line we visit. So finally, our algorithm looks as follows. So we are going to iterate this. We pick two corresponding epipolar line at random. So I pick one pair of image on one epipolar line at random on the corresponding one. Then I compute fully the cost of the matching cost between the patches taken from one and the patches taken on the other. Then I optimize my path in my matrix, my continuous path P star that minimize my loss under constraint. Then now that this is done, I can consider the matching on the path as the actual correct matching, and the matching outside as the negative matching, and use then I come back to the exact same scheme as the 2016 paper by Le Guin, and then we use standard backprop. Interestingly, we initialize the network with a standard weight randomization, so we do not need some fancy way of initializing. Why? Because random initialization, because of the Siamese structure of the network, two similar points, by continuity argument, two similar patches are sent to two similar signatures. So even with randomized weights, you have something very, very close to L1 similarity or in our standard inner product. So surprisingly, doing this, we do. So here I'm going to show two series of results. The first one, so those are three data sets standard in the stereo vision world, KT12, KT15, and Middlebury, for which we have the ground truth, because here we need to have a way of estimating if we are right or wrong. So we don't use the ground truth during training, but we use the ground truth in test to see how good we are. So those first results are winner-take-all error rate, so which means that here we take a patch, and we match it to the what we think is the best match in the other image, and we count with which probability we are correct. And we allow, I think, like 2 pixels error, which is standard protocol. And what is interesting here, that the error rate is better with our stuff, so the MCCNN FST is Kuhn paper, and the MCCNN semi-supervised is ours. And we see that we improve the error rate on both KT datasets, and we are virtually identical on Middlebury. What is less satisfying, but still quite surprising that it works so well, is that when we plug all this, because now those things are, when you have computed your matching costs, you can still, what people usually do is that they plug this in a heavy pipeline with a lot of ad hoc heuristics and regularization and design to fix the mistakes. If we plug this into this ad hoc, which is a very standard ranking for all the techniques in the field, we do slightly worse than the supervised method, and we do not understand exactly well at the moment what I suspect, and I'm not sure Stepan fully agrees, but what I suspect is that what we do, we are able to deal very well with noise in the labeling by definition, because we don't use the ground truth. If there was noise in the laser sensor, we don't care. We don't use this. So I'm suspecting that those pipelines are actually regularizing the mistakes which are caused by supervised errors in supervised systems, and we are completely free from this. And additionally, it's perfectly possible that the other method was tuned carefully for the pipeline, which we had not the time to do. Just to illustrate a little bit, what we can do is to take an image on the one epipolar line and look at the diagonal of the scores before and after training, and it's pretty nice because we see that it becomes extremely crisp after training, which is consistent. It really found a way of making things different. Another image, another line. And what we can also do is to look at a bunch of patches and of mistakes, and to look at the patch of the left image, what we predicted was the corresponding patch in the right image, and what the ground truth told us was the correct patch in the right image. And as you can see, there is what looks sometimes look like a labeling mistake, so typically the fourth column. And otherwise, it's kind of clear that it's going to be hard to do better just without more context. So just by the patches themselves, we are really doing a very good job. So probably the next step would be to look at more contextual information. Okay, so the conclusion is that without labeling and using a kind of pretty brutal regularization based on a very strong physical constraint, we can do without labels, which opens the way to training on an extremely large scale, because unlabeled stereo data, we have plenty of them. And also, the next step for us is now to wait to process the actual data from CASIS, which is going to be extremely rewarding. So we have an archive paper. So this is currently under review at CVPR, and hopefully there will be a CVPR paper. Otherwise, so we have currently already an archive, and if you're interested by the two other work I presented, which was macro-action discovery and the training of a detector using a consistency of motions, it was ICML and one CVPR paper. Thanks for your attention.
Thanks very much. Questions?
Realize we don't see you when we are here at all.
Maybe nobody is here anymore.
So thank you very much for fascinating talk. It's interesting that you have chosen to use unsupervised setting, which is much more challenging. Did you consider, for example, synthetic data for training or something like that?
No. Well, so
No, in that case. So it's something.
Using
synthetic data. So the question was, could we have used synthetic data instead of using unsupervised learning? So as a matter of fact, there is even a stronger way of doing this, which is to train on other data. So we could train on Kitty, Middlebury, and then apply to. So we have results in the paper where we showed that you really have a gain. Training on the actual data set you are going to deal with. And now if we use synthetic data, you are just pushing all the difficulties into the design of an actual synthetic generative model. So this could make a lot of sense, but then I would be presenting a long work about generating realistic synthetic data.
Other questions?
Hi, thank you very much. My understanding is that the robot or the camera has to stop to take the two pictures, the stereo pictures, and then analyze them. But how far are you from having the stuff moving on Mars and doing this stuff real time?
So here, this is an orbiter. So it's actually a probe taking a bunch continuously. So here, I'm starting to talk about stuff. Anton and Stepan would probably be. So it's actually a probe taking series of pictures constantly on moving the camera physically so that it has multiple angle of view of different points. This is not. Or maybe I don't.
But
I did
the,
not
the robot itself, where on which you have the camera, does it move on Mars?
So this is an orbiter. This is not a robot. This is an orbiter. This is a satellite.
Okay,
this is a probe
yeah.
cycling around.
Uh-huh.
So, on the.
Okay. So it's not at all. How is it called? You cannot do this on the surface of Mars.
No, we should not talk about descending on the surface for this mission because it was a bit so-so.
Okay. Yeah.
Any other questions?